through Jesus Christ.
O come, Emmanuel, and ransom captive Israel that mourns in lonely exile here, until the Son of God appear. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou day spring, come and cheer our spirits by thine advent here. Disperse the glooming clouds of night, and death's dark shadows put to flight. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, thou wisdom from on high, and order all things far and nigh. To us a path of knowledge show, and cause us in a ways to go. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel. O come, desire of nations, bind all peoples in one heart and mind, but bid envy, strife, and quarrel cease. Fill all the world with heaven's peace. Rejoice, rejoice, Emmanuel shall come to thee, O Israel.
Isaiah 40:1-5. Comfort, comfort my people, says your God. Speak tenderly to Jerusalem and cry to her that her warfare is ended, that her iniquity is pardoned, that she has received from the Lord's hand double for all her sins. A voice cries, in the wilderness prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in the desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, every mountain and hill made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. And the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all flesh shall see it together, for the mouth of the Lord has spoken.
Expected Jesus, born to set thy people free from our fears and sins. Release us, let us find our rest in thee. Israel, strength and consolation, hope of all the earth thou art, dear desire of every nation, joy of every longing heart. Born thy people to deliver, born a child and yet a king, born to reign in us forever. Now thy gracious kingdom bring, by thine own eternal spirit rule in all our hearts alone. By thine all-sufficient merit raise us to thy glorious throne.
Isaiah 9, 2 through 6. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who dwelt in a land of deep darkness, on them has light shone. You have multiplied the nation. You have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as they are glad when they divide the spoil. For the yoke of his burden and the staff for his shoulder, the rod of his oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For every boot of the trampling warrior in battle tumult and every garment rolled in blood will be burned as fuel for the fire. For to us a child is born, to us a son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace.
What child is this who laid to rest on Mary's lap is sleeping, whom angels greet with anthems sweet, while shepherds watch are keeping? This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him laud, the babe, the son of Mary. Why lies he in such mean estate, where ox and ass are feeding? Good Christian, fear for sinners hear, the silent word is pleading. This King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary. So bring him incense, gold, and myrrh, come peasant king, to own him. The King of Kings salvation brings, let loving hearts enthrone him. This is Christ the King, whom shepherds guard and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Mary.
A reading from the prophet Micah. But you, O Bethlehem Ephratah, who are too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you shall come forth for me one who is to be ruler in Israel, whose coming forth is from of old, from ancient days. Therefore, he shall give them up until the time when she who is in labor has given birth. Then the rest of his brothers shall return to the people of Israel, and he shall stand and shepherd his flock in the strength of the Lord, in the majesty of the name of the Lord his God, and they shall dwell secure. For now he shall be great to the ends of the earth.
Little town of Bethlehem, how still we see thee lie. Above thy deep and dreamless sleep, the silent stars go by. Yet in thy dark street shineth the everlasting light. The hopes and fears of all the years are met in thee tonight. For Christ is born of Mary and gathered all above. While mortals sleep, the angels keep their watch of wondering love. O morning stars, together proclaim the holy birth, and praises sing to God the King, and peace to men on earth. How silently the wondrous gift is given. So God imparts to human hearts the blessings of his hand. No ear may hear his But in this world of sin, where meek souls will receive him still, the dear Christ enters in. O holy child of Bethlehem, descend to us, we pray. Cast out our sin and enter in. Be born in us today. We hear the Christmas angels, the great glad tidings tell. Oh, come to us, abide in us, our Lord Emmanuel.
A reading from the Gospel according to Luke. In those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be registered. This was the first registration when Quirinius was governor of Syria. And all went to be registered, each to his own town. And Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the town of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and lineage of David, to be registered with Mary, his betrothed, who was with child. And while they were there, the time came for her to give birth, and she gave birth to her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling cloths and laid him in a manger, because there was no place for them in the inn.
A book was written long ago about a man that we all know. The prophets claimed he would save the world, born unto a virgin girl in a dirty barn in the promised land. The Son of God and the Son of Man looked at him and called him Jesus. There in the hills of Bethlehem, no one had any room for them. They knew that child was a real life changer, lying there in a king-sized manger. Shepherds watched their flocks nearby when an angel appeared in the sky. He told them not to be afraid. The Messiah was born today. He ain't in a palace lined with gold. You'll find him in a manger wrapped in swaddling clothes.
When they did, they bowed before him. There in the hills of Bethlehem, no one had any room for them. They knew that child was a real life changer, lying there in a king-sized manger. There may not have been a crown on his head, but he fulfilled every word the prophet said. There in the hills of Bethlehem, no one had any room for them. And they knew that child was a real life changer, lying there in a king-sized manger. King-sized manger.
A reading found from the Gospel according to Luke. And in the same region, there were shepherds out in the field, keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were filled with great fear. And the angel said to them, "Fear not, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy that will be for all the people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among those with whom he is pleased." When the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us."
Joy to the world, the Lord is come. Let earth receive her King. Let every heart prepare him room, and heaven and nature. and heaven and heaven and nature sing. Joy to the earth, the Savior reigns. Let men their songs employ, while fields and floods, rocks, hills, and plains repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy. Repeat, repeat the sounding joy. No more let sins and sorrows grow, nor thorns infest the ground. He comes to make his blessings flow. Far as the curse is found, far as the curse is found, far as the curse is found. He rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations the glories of his righteousness, and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, and wonders, wonders of his love.
A reading from the Gospel according to Luke.
And they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the baby lying in a manger. And when they saw it, they made known the saying that had been told them concerning this child. And all who heard it wondered at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured up all these things, pondering them in her heart. And the shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. May the Lord add his blessings to the reading of his word. Amen.
Thank you.
funny thing happened on the way to Christmas Eve service, or preparing for Christmas Eve service. The last couple weeks was getting ready and looking back. I always look at previous years and see what was happening, see about what to tweak, what to change, what to keep, what have you. I could not find last year's Christmas Eve service everywhere I looked. I looked on my computer, in the files. It wasn't there. The script wasn't there. The bulletin wasn't there. It was nowhere to be found. I went and looked in the hard copies, because I keep hard copies of everything. Yeah, I'm one of those. It wasn't there. I could not figure it out for the life of me. What was going on? It took me at least 3 days before I went, Doug, do you remember what happened last year? It snowed. We had to cancel Christmas Eve service, which was on a Saturday night, Christmas Day service, which was on Sunday morning. We had to cancel it all. It was kind of bad out there. And then today, the high got up to 64. Kind of interesting, is it not? When I was looking, one of the things that I noticed was that I shared a story from this little book that I've shared with y'all before. It's called The Good News from North Haven. It's written by a Presbyterian pastor, and his name is Michael Linvall. And it's, for those of you familiar with Lake Wobegon, think Lake Wobegon. It's one of those types of stories. As he is, it's not him per se, but, you know, he's taking those persona, this pastor. And there are two Christmas stories in here, and I shared one. And tonight, I thought I would share the other one. I have to give my fair warning. Our Presbyterian, you're going to hear about baptism, and they're talking about sprinkling the infants. Of course, we're Baptists. We don't do that. But listen to the story all the same. I think you might hear something. Annie and the kids and I have come at last to be at home in this little town once unknown and unimaginable to us. Even so, that honeymoon between the pastor and the congregation is long since past, as witnessed by events that began to unfold the Sunday before Thanksgiving. In coffee hour after the worship service, a taciturn, silver-haired pillar of the congregation named Angus McDowell informed me that his son Larry and Larry's wife Sherry, who live in Spokane, Washington, there in the Dakotas, would be visiting for the Thanksgiving weekend. Sherry, it seems, had just presented the McDowell clan with a son named, believe it or not, Angus Larry. However, Angus informed me they were planning on calling him Skip, which name Skip's grandfather spat disdainfully out of his mouth. Since they were going to be in town, and since Sherry's folks just live in Mankato, and since this was going to be a big reunion, they wanted me to do the baby, as Angus put it, next Sunday. I got Angus out of coffee hour and into my study for an informal discussion about the integrity of the sacrament of baptism, which is what I assumed he meant by doing the baby. I asked Angus about Larry and Sherry's church affiliation in Spokane, explaining that it was best for a child to be baptized in the church where he would be raised. It seems, though, that they had not yet settled on the church that they liked, though they'd been there 9 years. I talked about the importance of the parents' commitment to the faith and the fact that they are asked to make some rather sweeping and deep promises in the course of it all. Angus soon caught my drift. Larry and Sherry ought to find a church home out in Spokane and have Skip baptized there. Angus listened to all this in rather dignified and formal silence. He offered no response, much less argument. He simply rose without a word, shook my hand, and thanked me for my time. Fool that I was, I thought that the matter was settled. Angus is an elder of the church and one of that dwindling breed of courtly, gentle, but inflexibly stiff patriarchs of the church. In my experience, they seem to wear nothing but dark blue serge suits, a sort of uniform identifying them as members of an army in defense of the status quo. I remember encountering a whole flock of these blue-suited elders some 25 years ago on the day I was set before the church board to be examined for my confirmation. They were seated around a long, dark mahogany table in the church boardroom, 8 or 10 of them, all in their dark blue suits, and me, a skinny little 13-year-old in a corduroy jacket with sleeves 3 inches too short. They welcomed me. And then one of them, the one with wire-rimmed glasses, asked me my prearranged question from the catechism: what is effectual calling? I had been practicing the answer, which I can still recite, for 3 months. But something about his look and the way he emphasized the word effectual threw me off balance. I almost wet my pants. I believe I then gave the answer for the question, what is predestination? They confirmed me anyway, not out of mercy, but because I was 13, and when you're 13 and from a Presbyterian family, you were confirmed. They were hardly going to permit my fogginess on predestination and effectual calling to alter tradition. Serge-suited elders are a resolute and determined lot. True to his type, after Angus left my office, he simply spoke with all the members of the board about a special meeting to approve the baptism of Angus Larry. They had the meeting, asked me to please stop by, and voted 9-0 in favor of the baptism. So, on the morning of the Sunday after Thanksgiving, we did little Angus Larry. The congregation has an odd little baptismal custom. The pastor, I was gently informed when we first came here, always asked, who stands with this child? And then the whole extended family of the little one rises and remains standing for the ceremony. So, Angus Larry in my arms, I asked, who stands with this child? And up stood Angus in his blue serge suit and his wife Minnie and Sherry's folks from Mankato and a couple of cousins. After church, everybody rushed home to turkey leftovers, and I went back into the sanctuary to turn off the lights. A middle-aged woman, dressed Salvation Army style, was sitting in the front pew with a black plastic purse in her lap. I knew her as someone who always sat in the very last pew, as close to a door as possible, but I did not know her name. She seemed at a loss for words and was hesitant about looking at me for very long. She finally said her name was Mildred Corey and commented as to how lovely the baptism was. After another long pause, she said that her daughter Tina had just had a baby and, well, the baby ought to be baptized, shouldn't it? I suggested that Tina and her husband should call me and we would discuss the appropriateness of baptism. Mildred hesitated again, and then, catching and holding my eyes for the first time, said, Tina's got no husband. Tina's just 18, and she was confirmed in this church 4 years ago. She used to come out for the senior high fellowship, but then she had started to see this older boy out of high school. She hesitated for a moment, gathered her courage, and let the rest of the story tumble out fearlessly. Then she got pregnant and decided to keep the baby, and she wants to have it baptized here in her own church. But she's nervous to come and talk to you, Reverend. She's named the baby James, she said, Jimmy. I said that I would bring the request to the church board for approval. When the matter came up at the meeting, there was a moot question or two about why in the world Tina Corey was keeping the baby. I had started to explain what everybody already knew, namely that Tina was a member of the church, an unwed mother, and that I didn't know who the father was. They all knew who the father was, of course. This is a small town. The father was young Jimmy Hawthorne, who had recently chosen a career in his nation's armed forces and was now completing basic training at Fort Bragg. A few questions were asked as to whether we could be certain that Tina would stick to the commitment she was making in having her child baptized. The Angus Larry affair had me set in a feisty mood, and I remarked that she and little Jimmy were, after all, right here in town where we could give them support. I did not have to say, and not in Spokane. They all understood that. The real problem was the picture of the baptism that we all had in our heads. Tina, pimples on her chin, little Jimmy in her arms, big Jimmy long fled to North Carolina, and Mildred Corey the only one who would stand when the question was asked. It hurt to think of it, but they approved it, of course. The baptism was scheduled for the last Sunday in Advent. The church was full, as it always is the Sunday before Christmas. The rumored snow had not yet come, though the sky was heavy with it. After the sermon, the elder who was to assist me in the baptism stood up beside me at the baptismal fount and read the words I had written out on a 3x5 card. Tina Corey presents her son for baptism. He kept looking at the card and not at Tina, who was rising to come forward, as if there were some further point he wished to make. Down the aisle she came, nervously, briskly, smiling at me only, shaken slightly with month-old Jimmy in her arms, a blue pacifier stuck in his mouth. The scene hurt, all right, every bit as much as we all knew it would. So young this mother was, and so alone. One could not help but remember another baby born long ago to a young and unwed mother in difficult circumstances. I read the opening part of the service, noting Mildred Corey sitting strangely out of place in a front pew. Then I asked, who stands with this child? I nodded at Mildred slightly to coax her to her feet. She rose slowly, looking to either side, and then returned my smile. My eyes went back to my service book. I was just about to ask Tina the parents' questions of commitment when I became aware of movement in the pews. Angus McDowell had stood up in his blue serge suit, Minnie beside him, then a couple of other elders stood up. Then the sixth grade Sunday school teacher stood up, then a new young couple in church, and soon before my incredulous eyes, the whole church was standing up with little Jimmy. Tina was crying, of course, and Mildred Corey was holding onto the pew in front of her as though she were standing on a deck of a ship railing in a great wind, which, in a way, she was. The unexpectedness of this departure from the routine at first disquieted, but then quiet as all, even little Jimmy, who had been wiggling and squeaking as though he might be preparing to screech. As the water touched his forehead, he seemed almost to focus his infant senses. The water rolled back into the thin wisp of baby hair down the bridge of his nose and onto his cheek. His eyes looked to the side as though he were concentrating on something. Every eye was on the child who was for a moment everybody's baby. I broke my gaze and looked up to the congregation to let them know I was about to offer the baptismal prayer. I noticed Angus straining to see Jimmy from three pews back. The old man was looking into the infant face with an open mouth smile that surely remembered his own baby, now a grown man with a baby of his own. The scripture reading that morning had been some verses from 1 John. See what great love the Father has given us that we should be called children of God. No man has ever seen God. If we love one another, God abides in us, and his love is perfected in us. There is no fear in love, but perfect love casts out fear. In that baptism, those old words came alive. They were clothed in flesh, and everybody saw it. That story, every time I read it, kind of does something right here for all sorts of reasons. The scriptures tells us that Christ Jesus came into this world to die upon the cross for all of us when we were dead in our sins. Jesus came into this world to stand up for each and every one of us. Praise God. How could he do that? Doesn't matter. Praise God, he did. That's all that really matters. As Jesus stands for us, do we stand for Jesus? I want to say, grab your hymnals. Let's sing Stand Up for Jesus. Do we stand up for one another? Think about that today. This week, in this coming year, praise God, our Lord stands up for us. May we stand up for him, and may we stand up for one another. Indeed.
Gracious Heavenly Father, we come to you this evening thanking you for the eternal gift of Jesus. Father, we thank you that Jesus humbled himself to become a lowly man, setting his godliness aside so he can be just like us. God, in this Christmas season, no matter how we may feel, we can be rest assured that Jesus knows, Jesus understands, and Jesus cares for each and every one of us. We thank you that Jesus came to be a servant, to be an example for each and every one of us. God, just as Jesus washed the feet of the man who would betray him just hours later, may we humble ourselves to serve the lowly, to serve those who betray us, to serve those who harm us. God, we thank you for the sacrifice once for all that was made on Calvary. Through the blood of Jesus, we can have grace and mercy and life. God, we thank you and praise you for the eternal sacrifice of Jesus. And God, even more, we thank you that when he was taken down from that cross, he didn't stay in a grave. He rose victorious 3 days later, and he sits at your right hand. And God, that same power that rose Jesus from the grave dwells within each and every one of us. May we use our gifts, that same power, to spread the light of Christ to a dying world. God, if 12 disciples could spread Christianity as they did, what could a congregation this size do for you? God, we thank you and praise you for Jesus. And it's in his precious and holy name we pray. Amen.